Welcome, friends. I am very happy to be back in Sacramento and see the love and devotion of spiritual seekers here. It's a beautiful experience to see seeking in somebody, seeking for the truth, not seeking worldly things. We all seek worldly things also, many for survival, many for our desires to be fulfilled. But seeking the truth, seeking who we are, what is our purpose in life, what are we here for as human beings, that seeking is a very different thing, and that seeking leads us to realize the truth. The secret of finding the truth is seeking. If you seek, you will find. No question about it. Whoever seeks, finds. The question sometimes is that if you seek in the wrong direction, you will not find. The direction must be right. If you want to seek something in the west and you start moving east, you will not find it. But if you move in the right direction, you will find. Now, if you are seeking who we are, then you must seek within your own self. You can't be asking other people who we are, because that is outside. If you want to find out who you are seeking is yourself, then you must go within your own self. There is this little problem that we don't know how to go within our own self. We treat our body as ourself, and we think maybe by closing our eyes, we are within ourselves. We close our eyes and see nothing but darkness. And then we say there is nothing inside us. The truth is, closing your eyes does not take you anywhere inside. The eyes are still looking outside. At least when the eyes are open, you can see what is outside. If you close your eyes, you don't see even what is outside, but you're not seeing anything inside. Therefore, closing your eyes and sitting and saying, I am going to see something inside, does not work. I have not found anybody who has closed his eyes and said, I found the truth, or I found what was inside me. Because we are still dealing with the physical body. And so long as we think we are the physical body alone, that we are a material physical body, then we will only know what is physically true. We can only examine physical, material things with this physical body. We cannot find anything beyond that. Whether you close your eyes or open your eyes does not matter. Therefore, when we want to seek who we are, we must go back to the very voice that says, I want to seek myself. Where is it coming from? You don't have to speak this. Supposing you don't speak these words, and only say in your mind that you want to seek yourself. Only in your mind, where is that voice coming from? It's not coming from outside. It's in the head. When you put this question to yourself without speaking with the body, without using your tongue, you put this question to yourself with your mind inside. Who am I? Just put this question. Who am I? Who is asking this question? Where am I? If you put that question and know where you are talking from, you will know that you are not talking from the body at all. The body is not involved in that question. You are asking something that is not physical, because there is no voice, there is no body, and yet you are asking this question with your thought process inside your head. Therefore, in order to find out where you speak your thoughts from, where you are behind your eyes in the head, you have to go there. Unless you go there, closing the eyes does not work. Now the difficulty is, how do we go there? There is one way of going to any place we like. Not physically speaking, but mentally speaking, we can go wherever we like by putting our attention on the destination where we want to go. Supposing now we want to walk outside on the street. Either we take our body outside, which means a physical activity, or we use our mind to think of the street outside and start walking there with our imagination. That's also, we have gone to the street, but not with the physical body. How did we go? What constitutes imagination? What made us see the street and say we are outside? If you contemplate this very question, you will find we went outside with our attention. This is the greatest gift we have. Human attention is the greatest gift given to a human being by the Creator. Because with attention, you can go wherever you like, even within your own self. With the attention, you can go outside. With the attention, you can go inside. With the attention, you can place the attention at the very point where you ask the question, who really am I? Who is it speaking inside my head, which is not tied to my tongue, not tied to my body, but still I'm speaking inside? That is why when you seek to find out who are you other than the physical body, where are you operating from, it takes you directly behind the eyes, in the center of the head, where your thought process is going on, from where attention is flowing out everywhere. Now, there is a little catch at this point. The catch is that we have been always using our attention to focus on things outside. We read books, we put our attention on the books. We talk to friends, we put our attention on the friends. We do other things, we put attention on other things outside. They're all outside. We have learned very well how to throw our attention from inside our head outside through the eyes, through the hands, through the rest of the body, through the ears. All these apparatus, the sensory perceptions that we have on our system, on our body, we are using to put our attention outside. We don't know how to put the attention inside, because that would not mean focusing attention. It would mean withdrawing attention. Now, withdrawal of attention to its source is very different from focusing attention on something. We have learned very well how to focus attention. So the confusion arises when an enlightened person, a mystic who has withdrawn his attention and found the truth, tells us, withdraw your attention inside yourself, in the center of the head, behind these eyes. We try to focus our attention there, and we don't withdraw. We never practice withdrawal. When we try to focus, what do? We again close our eyes to make it dark. And then we imagine the darkness in front of us to be inside our head. And then we focus ourselves somewhere in the area in front of our eyes and think we are now focusing ourselves on ourselves inside. That's not true. We are still focusing outside. Some people said we sit for long hours of meditation and we are able to see things inside. I said, what do you see? They said, we can see ourselves, for example, sitting and meditating. I said, let's imagine that you are seeing yourself meditating. Okay, is the image that you see of yourself meditating, is that inside you or outside? It's inside because our eyes are closed. How can it be outside? I said, all right. Now here are your hands, and you can easily know where your eyes are, whether your eyes are open or closed. If my eyes are open, I can touch my eyes. If my eyes are closed, I can still touch my eyes. I know where the body is. I know where the eyes are. I can touch it. I said, now do the experiment with me. Now make that image which you see inside, and then bring your hands up. And as they bring their hands up, by the time their hands have reached the eye, they've already crossed the image. The image was outside, not inside at all. Just because the eyes were closed, they thought the image is inside. What a big error. So when we are trying to focus attention on anything, we are always outside. That is why focusing attention in meditation does not yield any result. And yet people are spending years and years trying to focus attention on something they think is inside. You don't go inside like that. Now, if you want to know how to reverse the process, take the same example. I am seeing something of myself sitting there, but I am not that. Then who am I? I am the one looking at that image. That the one that is looking at the image is behind, not outside. So when you want to put your attention behind, you learn the art of withdrawing attention. It's a simple trick, but it takes practice. It takes practice to withdraw attention to where you are, where you believe you are, from where you operate as a wakeful human being, to withdraw your attention behind. If you can do that, you have made a great headway toward realizing the truth. So many people, like my friends, have been caught up in this thing, that they just close their eyes, they try to focus attention on which is outside, and they think they have gone inside. And nothing happens. How can anything happen? They are still exactly in the same position. It's a tiresome meditation. They get tired after the meditation. And normally, if we sit with friends and chat around with lovely company, we don't get tired. Our legs don't get tired. If we spend the same time in meditation, our legs get tired, and we try to give up. It's terrible. The same thing changes into something that we don't like. We don't want to do it. We force ourselves to do meditation. How can we succeed when we force ourselves to do something we don't even like? That means our mind doesn't accept the search for truth to be a viable thing or something that will really happen. And ultimately we give up and say, maybe it is all grace, we'll wait for some good times to come, and grace will come, and this meditation has not worked for us. I am bringing this point to your notice because in my various travels all over the world, I have found that people are making this mistake of thinking that by closing their eyes and making an image of themselves, a little image of themselves, they are actually sitting inside. That's not true. So to jump over this particular hurdle, I do recommend that when you see the image, think of who is looking at the image. That's you. Where are you looking from? Not where the image is, but behind. Pull yourself behind where you are, in the same space, in the same darkness, in the same space that you see around you. In the same space, you pull yourself behind and you will see a light, you will see things that you've never seen before. That's the gateway to your own true home, gateway to Sachkhand, gateway to your ultimate destination. So if we are roaming around the gateway and not entering the gateway, we don't find anything. But once you are able to put your attention there, and that is how we travel in our consciousness, in our awareness, we travel with our attention. So once you discover that you are not an image to be in front of you, but you are the one which is looking at the image, then put your attention on yourself. You are who you are, where you are. And think of that. Think of nothing else. Think of only that you are looking at things all around you. You're looking at the dark space, it becomes a white space, it becomes a colorful space. Even when you see yourself in the darkness, you can still see yourself. These eyes do not take any part in that seeing at all. That seeing is totally different. These eyes do not see what is inside when the eyes are closed. You can close your eyes, cover them up, wrap them up, and you will still see. Who is seeing? Not these eyes, but inner eyes. You can call it imagination. When you imagine something with closed eyes, you can still see. You can imagine a sunrise or a sunset, and you will see the sunrise in your eyes, with your eyes closed. So what those eyes which see inside, they will start seeing many things. And this is not something, it's a theoretical thing I'm talking. I am talking of something practical, which I would like you to join me and do. Would you like to do that today? How many of you are interested in doing it right today? Okay, this afternoon itself. I don't want that I should be just giving a lecture and going away. I want that if what I'm saying makes any sense, and you are all seekers, that's why you are here, that you should be able to see what I'm talking about and experience it yourself. On this path, which we call the spiritual path, there is no place for blind faith. It's not based on faith. It's based on experience. The faith is involved in taking the first step, that should we do it at all or not? Somebody says, I don't believe in anything. You say, okay, then you don't do anything. But there is the element of faith not coming from somebody telling us outside, have faith. It is coming from our own seeking inside. And the seeking comes from very, very different kind of experiences in the outside physical world. Very often we are upset with the world. Very often we are distressed. We are disappointed. And we feel inside, this is not our place. Somehow we are trapped here. These are the kind of feelings that make us take the first step. Even that is not blind faith. The seeking comes from within. I have met people in their 60s and 70s, old people. And when they met and talked to me about this path, they said, this is what we were looking for from childhood. And all their 60, 70 years of life, they could not tell anybody that this is what they were looking for. The seeking hides inside us. It's the seeking that comes out and brings the first step. That let us try. If something is there, let's try. When the first step is successful, then you have faith for the next step based upon the experience of the first step. There's no blind faith. Each step should lead to an experience of the next step. So that is why when I share these teachings with you, they come from the teachings I got from my master, Hazur Maharaj Baba Sawan Singh, great master. He taught me these things long ago. And I have been practicing, sometimes badly, sometimes good, sometimes misunderstand what he's saying, sometimes trying to get clarification from him. But it is after all so many decades of experience, I've come to find that what he said was the truth if you follow it correctly. And that is why I'm sharing these things because of the seva that I'm doing for that master in order to help others in this part of the world who he predicted will be the next future of seekers and realizers of truth. Great master even said that the axis of spirituality, which has been there in the East for so long, is going to shift to the West. And also he mentioned it will not only shift to the West, it will localize itself in a big way in the United States of America. Now, I don't know whether he said that because he was talking to a man who was from the United States of America, a doctor named Julian Johnson. He was talking to him, the man who wrote those books, Path of the Masters and the Great Master in the East and so on. Whether he was saying this because he was from the United States, but he did mention the United States. I worked all my life in India. I was born in India. And why am I here? Because when I heard him, I heard the conversation myself between Dr. Julian Johnson and the great master. When he was predicting that things will move to the West, I was there. And not only that, then in 1937, great master wrote a number of letters to people in the West, in the United States particularly. He wrote to them that your turn has come, the spirituality is going to move from the East to the West, and you will find perfect masters in the West. And you have had a lot of masters in India, China, Middle East. Now the turn for the West has come. And the West, which has been searching for so much wealth and industrial growth and so on, that will shift to the East. And India and China, which produce great mystics, will now run after more business, more industries, more wealth. And the spiritual wealth will move over there. As I grew up, I was working with a government job, and I retired. I said, first step to take, go and see what is going to happen in the West. So I came here to take a ringside seat to see the show. And the show is going on, and I can see it. So that is why it's a great opportunity for people living in this part of the world to have the benefit which we got in abundance in the East earlier. So why I'm sharing all these things with you is to make the spiritual path a practical experience for you and not merely a business of faith, not blind faith. Living faith, yes. What's the difference between blind faith and living faith? Blind faith is believing a statement somebody made. And you believe it because somebody made the statement and you just believe it blindly with no verification. Living faith is having faith that develops every day like a living thing. That every day some new experience happens adding on to that faith. And new experience verifying and validating that faith. So that is why this path that I share with you is a living faith and not blind faith. Now going back to the question of meditation, what happens if you are able to achieve that? you are able to see yourself. Is there something coming in the way of doing this? Is there something in us preventing us from doing it? If you look at your own lives, there is something that prevents us from seeking the truth. What is that? What is the hurdle? What is the great obstacle that comes in the way of doing it? If it is so simple, and we all know it, what is the hurdle? You will find the hurdle is your own mind, nothing outside. Nobody from outside is stopping you from finding something inside your own self. The obstacle to going within is also built inside yourself. And that obstacle is your own mind. Because the mind has been trained and used and employed for something very different than going within. The mind has been employed to go and experience the external created universe. Therefore, the mind runs all the time outside. Therefore, the mind gets attached to things outside. Then the mind wants more desires. So these two things which the mind does, desire and attachment, prevents us from going within. So we know the obstacle. The obstacles are the built-in desires of the mind to go and look for things outside. And also, the mind wants to attach to those things that it desires and not forget about them. The attachment outside is so strong that when we try to pull our attention inside, the attention is a component of the mind itself. The attention when we put inside, the mind takes the attention away to where we are attached. Haven't we all seen that when we meditate, how so many things outside come into the mind? Sometimes I tell people, if you have lost your keys, meditate, you'll find your keys. The mind will run outside to find the keys, just but not let you do the meditation. So therefore, this mind which takes you outside, what is the mind? What is mind? Is it our own inner self? When we say we are going to put our attention somewhere, is the mind speaking? Is the mind ourself, or is it just an instrument that we are using? Is it like the body? Is it like we have a body? We think it's ourself. It's not ourself. We know we operate inside the body. Is the mind also just a body, or is it our own self? Now, when you examine that issue, a very big issue on the spiritual path, when you examine, is the mind ourselves, or we are something separate from the mind, using the mind, then you come to a very interesting conclusion. And that is, the mind is merely a thinking machine. It thinks all the time. It's a living thing. It's an inner body of ours that thinks to survive. Like this body has a pulse rate, has a heartbeat and a breathing. It survives with heartbeat and breathing. The mind survives by thinking. It's not us. What are we then? Ultimately, who are we? If you want to go even beyond the mind, who are we? We are the life force that makes the mind alive, that makes the senses alive, that makes the body alive. We are the life force. What is life force? Life force is that which makes us aware that we are alive, which makes us see the whole world. Therefore, our awareness, our consciousness is per se our own self. The rest is just put around it for experience. We have a mind to think, but we don't have to think all the time to be alive. We have so many experiences which do not involve thinking. And I'll give you an example of three of those things which happen to us, and the mind is not involved, the body is not involved, and the senses are not involved. What are those three things? One, intuitive knowledge, gut feeling, without thinking. Where does it come from? When we have an intuitive knowledge of something, we just feel it's true. No thought. In fact, thought is going against it. And we still say, no, that's true. Where does it come from? The intuitive knowledge does not come from the mind, nor from senses, nor from body. So there's a source for that. And it's a conscious experience. Therefore, the source is consciousness itself. Second, the experience of love for somebody. When we love, do we think about it to have love? Love just comes. When we think about it, we can destroy it or make it further grow. But thoughts follow the experience of love. Love is not an experience of the mind at all. You can't think yourself into love, but you can love and then think about it. So therefore, here's a second experience of our own self, of our consciousness not connected with the mind. Third experience, the appreciation of beauty and having that blissful experience of enjoying beauty. That comes suddenly. What's the distinction between these and the functioning of the mind? The biggest distinction is the mind always operates in time. Even the smallest thought takes time. Every thinking that we do with the mind is in time and space. But the awareness of ourselves, of our own real self, does not take any time at all. It's beyond time and space. When you examine this distinction, that is why we use different terminology. We call our own true self as the soul. The soul, not the mind. And the mind is joined with the soul in order to have an experience of time-space and vast experiences that open up by using this particular computer-like accessory called the mind. That is how awareness is being assisted by the mind to have these experiences. And then the mind, in order to have more subtle experiences, is joined with another cover of sense perceptions, where we divide perception into seeing separately, hearing separately, touching separately, smelling separately. These divisions into the five senses of perception are a further enhancement to having a variety of experiences. And to top it all, we put it all into a human physical body, and all these things operate together. So we think that we are who we are because we are conscious, alive. We have a thinking machine, the mind that works. We have sense perceptions to divide our perceptions and experiences. We have a physical body to move around here and have an experience of the physical world. It's a great assemblage. It's a very great construction of how this world is created and experienced. But to be able to reverse this and go from the outer to the inner, it requires that we use attention in such a way that we can remove one cover and go to the next one and ultimately find who we are by removing all the covers. These are different covers upon ourselves. The mind is the first cover. The thinking machine is the first cover, which makes us believe because we think, therefore we are. The thinking machine is the self, which it is not. Thinking is merely a function of something added on to the consciousness. Then the next cover is the sense perceptions. Third cover is the physical body. Let's take these basic covers and remove one by one. Let's see what happens. When a person dies in the physical body, does he really die? Or is only the body dead and he's still there? We hear stories. We hear stories that people have had near-death experiences where they're separated from the body. They were still there. We hear stories of people who are able to practice out-of-body meditational techniques by which they can see their body separately from themselves. But those are stories. Can we do something to find this out? Now, either we kill ourselves, which is not good, that's criminal, or we can do something else. Something that is very, very workable, and that is have the experience of dying without actually dying. Dying while living. Now that experience is accessible to all of us. That means we can actually right now experience what we would be like when we die. And we can know exactly what we will look like, what we will be doing, what our capabilities will be when we die, before we actually die. Now what is death of the physical body? If you have seen people dying, they don't die all at once. They die in stages. I have seen people, terminal people, dying in the hospitals, in other places. What happens is that they die first in their extremities of their bodies. The dying person says, I don't know where my feet are. I don't know where my hands are. Later on, he doesn't know where the legs are, where the arms are, doesn't know where the torso is. He's rising in the air, as it were, flying in the sky, going to the top of the roof or something. They get these experiences as their consciousness, awareness of the different parts of physical body is being withdrawn by death. Ultimately, it comes to the head. While the extremities are being withdrawn, they are still talking to us. But when it crosses the heart, they can't talk, they can still see, we can see in their eyes. But when it reaches the head, their brain dead, they are dead. The body's got no life in it. That's the process. Can we recreate that process ourselves artificially? Yes, we can. And that's where the trick lies. That is where, through meditation, we can use a process by which you can have the exact experience of dying without actually dying. How do we achieve that? When we examine what makes us know that we have our external limbs and feet and hands, we find it is the scattering of our own attention into these areas that are making us know that we have hands and feet. It's not that we have to look at them. We can close our eyes till we know we have our hands and feet. That's because our attention is totally scattered throughout this body. And it's also scattered from the body all over the world. Now, if we are going to find a real spot for meditation behind the eyes, not meditation with the body, meditation with our internal imaginary body, which I will term as the astral body, which can sit inside, which watches from inside, which can see inside, which can hear inside, without these ears, without these eyes, if we meditate with that and draw our attention there, gradually we will think of nothing else but what is there. When that happens, we gradually withdraw our attention from the world, we withdraw our attention from the physical body, and we actually feel that we don't know where our hands and feet are. We actually gradually feel we don't know where the rest of the body is. Eventually we have no notion at all that there is a body. And that becomes our body. When that happens, we are dead. Though we are alive in the body, the heartbeat is the same, all vital forces are functioning the same way, yet the experience is as if we are not in the body, but not outside the body, not somewhere outside, but in our real form, where the body has disappeared and we have an inner body. That is called dying while living. With that experience, you will know exactly what will happen when you physically die. You will know exactly what happens to your consciousness, to your memory, to your mind, because they are all intact. So this is a very great thing possible in meditation. Meditation done correctly leads to your personal awareness of what happens when you die. And I tell you, one of the results is you'll never be afraid of death after that, because you know what it is. Otherwise, everybody is afraid of death. While driving here to this place, I opened my iPhone, and people send me jokes nowadays because they think I share jokes more than I share knowledge. One of the jokes was said, it's not a joke, it's just a statement, everybody wants heaven, but nobody wants to die. But an experience of heaven is possible without dying. When you withdraw your attention to that point, everything that is available there is available to you while you're still in the body and not aware of the body. Now, what a great experience that is. How few have got this, although they had the opportunity to get it. That's what makes me feel that I must remind people that please do it if you want to see it. You'll never be afraid of death after that, never. You will know exactly what will happen. You will be able to see with your own eyes your past lives, your future lives, your future life, if any, all the possibilities that are possible for you, how the programming has been done for creating a destiny for this life. All that is possible for a person to see personally. Now, this is no blind faith. This is personal experience. So that is why I say that you should be able to practice something that is personally available to you, and it is your experience, not somebody else's experience you believe in. That is why I suggest, by going there to the what I will now call third eye center, because others have also called it. Why is it called third eye? These two eyes are physical eyes, and we have a third eye. Even these two physical eyes, when they look out at this physical world, what is the purpose of having two eyes? We could have had one. I understand there were cyclops who used to have only one eye in the forehead. They had a very big problem. They never knew what is far, what is near. So by evolution, we came to two eyes so that we can know what is far and what is near. Did you know that's the only purpose of the two eyes? That they see two different pictures. And then they merge the pictures to create distance. And a spectroscopic image comes up, and we know that is near, that's far. That one eye would be confused. That two eyes give us the distance. Two ears give us the direction from where the sound is coming. Otherwise, one would have been enough. The two eyes are making a three-dimensional reality of what we are seeing. And that is why the two eyes function with two different images. Because when you see with this eye, it's looking at everything from here. This eye looking from here. They're different. When you try to merge them, it becomes one image. Where does it become one image? Not in the eye. Eyes are separate. Where do we join? If you just sit and think of this thing, this one simple question, where am I seeing the single image, a merged image from? It's not with these eyes, it's inside, and it's exactly at the place where you think from is the third eye center. Always. So even physically, we are always seeing from the third eye without knowing it. We think we see with the two eyes, but when we create one image with two eyes, we are pushing back our actual seeing to the third eye center, in the center of the head, behind the eyes. That place is physiologically also a very important place. The skull and the system, the way the body is built up, is protecting that place very well. That's where, even according to these medical people, the organs, the pineal gland, the other gland, the pituitary body, they lie in that area where we say is the third eye. And they say those control all the hormones of the body, they control so many things, all the triggers are coming from there. So actually, when we are awake and we are alive in this physical body, we are using that area of the head more than any other part of the body in order to have experiences of this physical world. So we listen from there, we see from there, we think from there, we contemplate on things we see from there. So everything we are doing from there, from third eye center. So when we put our attention back there, we are able to enhance our capability of seeing, touching, tasting, smelling. And then we realize that these sense perceptions are not on the physical body, but they are on our inner body at the third eye center. That's also a great experience. I sometimes do that experience of making people with their closed eyes in meditation at third eye center, eat things, smell flowers. So I might do it this afternoon for you. So you might experience that without those material things at all, you can have all the experiences of sense perceptions. So sense perceptions do not belong to the physical body. They are implanted in the physical body by the existence of another body inside, which operates like a sensory system, sensory body inside. We call it the astral body. That's something between this physical body and our mind. It's an intermediate stage of experience. So when we have the experience of an astral body, since it is not physical, it is light, there's no weight problem, we don't have any kind of diets and all that in the astral plane of consciousness, where we are only using the astral body, we can fly easily, there is no problem. And it's so natural, the life there is natural, we have a longer life there, we have a longer memory there. So all those things you can experience simply by withdrawal to the stage and disconnecting in awareness from this body, which remains fully alive and intact, but only an experience is generated inside. This is a great gift given to us, that in a human body, there are these centers where we can have unusual experiences. There are many centers below the physical eyes. They count six centers, six main centers, the chakras they call them. The six centers below are energy centers. Putting attention on each one of them generates different experiences, different sensory experiences. You can use all those six centers to have different energy experiences. In fact, all the energy in the physical body is operating in those six centers, being directed from the third eye center. So we sit in the brain, sit in as a conscious entity, using a body, we sit in the third eye center and we direct all the consciousness, attention to go and operate those centers and the energetic performance of the body. All forms of energy can be found in those six centers. Energy does not lie above the eyes. Energy is being operated by a mechanism below the eyes. But awareness is different. How aware you are is not energy. Awareness is knowledge, knowing what's going on. That awareness is at the eyes and above. The area of the physical body where energy operates is below the eyes, and the area where awareness operates is behind and above the eyes. The eyes are the meeting point. There are two eyes looking outside, two eyes looking inside. The two eyes looking outside are the beginning, and because they're two, they are often referred to in the series of explanations of the chakras as the two-petaled lotus. The two-petaled lotus are the eyes that look outside. And we can go down to the bottom to the four-petaled lotus, which is at the rectum. We can go to six-petaled lotus at the genitals. We can come to the more-petaled lotus at the intestinal area, at the navel. We get to more at the heart. And then come back to the eyes inside and look out again and go through the whole cycle. Many yogis are doing that. So many yogis who are practicing different forms of energetic experiences through techniques of yoga, techniques of putting attention on the centers, are actually doing it. And they are having great results of new types of energies that experience. And they think that experience of those energetic awakening of these centers is equivalent to a spiritual experience. That is not. It's an experience of the energy available in these physical different centers of the body, but it is not higher awareness. They don't see anything higher in awareness than what they see here. It may be a little different, but still seeing like this is not different seeing. If they want to have an awareness which is higher, they have to find in the area of awareness which is behind the eyes and above. The two-petaled lotus is the outer eye. The two-petaled lotus also opens inside and starts another cycle of similar awareness centers. They also are classified 2, 4, 6, 6, 8. They go on developing like that and go to the middle of the head and turn upwards in the head. This physical body has these different points built into the physiology of this body, and the great ability to put attention exclusively on one center opens up an experience of different types of energy or reality. It's a miracle, miraculous thing, that a body should be so built, not only for its own remarkable activity, how many miles of intestines and how many miles of nervous system is there and how much is working so beautifully, perfectly. Apart from that, the fact that you can have an awareness beyond the physical, within this body, it's the greatest miracle. And yet it is accessible to all of us who are aware of it and who can be guided how to go into those areas of awareness and not into the area of energy centers. So when I mention these experiences going inside, by withdrawing your attention from the physical body, you're able to go to the next level, which is an opening of a sensory body, which is more or less you will experience as if it is like the same body. Because the senses have developed that experience of this body, and when we move into that, till we can modify that with our own will, it remains similar to this body. And it functions, you can fly with it, you can go see things with this, and it is totally independent from the physical body. You can have an out-of-body experience, say by putting your attention in the energy center of the heart. When you have an out-of-body experience from the heart, you don't separate from the heart or from the body. You feel you're connected. In fact, you are afraid. There's a fear experienced by those who had that out-of-body experience that there's a silver cord attached to this physical body. They're just having a little extended experience outside, and if the cord snaps, they will die. That fear is there. But when you have a real experience that you can have a sensory system that is independent from the body, there's no fear involved. Fear disappears. So there are big differences in the two practices. Why I'm mentioning that many people think that yoga or yogic practices of energy centers is the same thing as raising of your awareness. It is not. The raising of awareness takes place when you go into the area of awareness, which is behind the eyes and above in this physical body. When you experience something like an astral body, it's a remarkable experience because you find that the power of sense perceptions is enhanced beyond what you can imagine with these physical body. Physical senses cannot see what the inner senses can see. That itself is a great thing. Not too many people have achieved it. Many have achieved it. All the heavens we speak about are in that area of experience. You can visit those heavens in that state. All the hells are there too. You can visit them in that state. The whole creation here in the physical world is almost like a copy taken from there. It's much vaster than this one, and yet it's the source of this one. It's a great experience to go to the source. So many people who say they have highest spiritual experience have gone there and stopped there. Because they found heaven, they found God, they found God sitting there. There's a God sitting there, the Creator sitting there, because that is still in space and time, and you can still see things separate from each other. It's still part of space and time. And therefore, when people say, we've seen God, they've seen the creative power that's sitting there in a personality, in a person, in a form. Now, here comes this question. Is that a permanent state? This is not a permanent state. The physical body is not a permanent state, nor is the physical world a permanent state. Everything changes here. Does everything change here? Yes, everything changes there too. It follows the same rule. Therefore, that also gets destroyed one day, like this physical world destroyed. The astral body also dies just like this physical body dies. It's only a higher form of awareness of our own self. But it's not ourself. It's still a form that we're adding on to ourselves. But that is where so many enlightened people have come and told us about that and called it our true home and called it Sachkhand. But there are a few who have gone beyond and found out that was just a form that we could still use sense perceptions, divided sense perceptions, to have the experience. They go further than that. How do they go further? Same process. They go in the head of that body and determine that how are we having the experiences from the third eye of the inner body. Meditation at that stage takes place in the third eye of the inner body, and we become unaware of the inner body and we open up to something totally new. Something where we are formless, or we have a form that no resemblance to this one, where there's no separation of perceptions, where we discover that what we are now wearing as a body is our mind, a thinking machine. That's our form at that time. The mind is also the causal body that causes all these experiences below, including the experiences of the astral and the physical world. This is something very remarkable that you can have access to that, to your mind. Now, these things one can, if one is very specially inclined, has been well trained to go and have the experience. Beyond that, you cannot go. Because all the struggle we do, all the effort we put in is with the mind. How can you go beyond the mind with the mind? And that is why, after that, nobody has been able to go on their own. It has to be some power that must pull you from beyond the mind to take you out of the mind. To your true self, now you need somebody. You need instructions and teaching even for the first stage. You need teaching even for understanding language over here. We need teachers at all time. And we need teachers to go to the first and second stage. But we need somebody who has gone beyond the mind in order to go beyond the mind. And such a person who is a human being available to us here, we call a perfect living master. A perfect living master is not a superhuman being. A perfect living master is totally human being, ordinary human being, just like us. No difference. Born like us, dies like us, falls sick like us, eats, drinks, and lives his life just like us. No difference at all. The only difference is in his awareness. He has reached the stage of awareness where he's beyond the mind. And what has taken him beyond the mind? Something that exists beyond the mind and does not exist within the realm of these three worlds. What exists beyond the mind is what I described in the beginning, which is a non-time-space experience, the experience of love, beauty, bliss, joy. Those things are there without the mind. Therefore, these perfect living masters, when they come and they pick us up, and our seeking is beyond the mind, our seeking is, we have had enough of this, we want to go to our real true home beyond these levels, then such a person accidentally, by coincidence, comes into our life. And comes into our life and expresses himself, who he is, through an unconditional love which we haven't seen elsewhere. Because it is the unconditional love of such a person that's going to pull us beyond the mind. No meditation will take us there. No struggle will take us there. No effort will ever take us there. It has to be a pull from beyond the mind to pull us. And the only thing that will pull us beyond the mind is unconditional love. Now, here is an ordinary person. He comes, he does ordinary things, talks ordinary stuff, behaves ordinary all the time. But when it comes to experience of love with such a person, we find it absolutely unconditional. Now, what is unconditional love? There is no judgment. He does not say you are good or bad. He does not judge you for anything. He does not say, because you are good, I will help you, and if you are not good, I will not help you. He will love you whether you love him or you don't love him. He will love you if you hate him, he will still love you. He will love you if you kill him, he will still love you. That's the kind of unconditional love these rare human beings have. They are very rare. You can imagine this kind of person who is not affected by anything outside and still is willing to love anyone who is a seeker of that area, seeker beyond the mind. If you are not seeking beyond the mind, he'll pass by you because you're looking for something else. But if you are seeking something beyond the mind, you have had enough of your mind also. Not only had enough of karma and enough of the events of this life, but you have had enough of your mind, enough of your thoughts. You are even tired of that. Then only you can say you are seeking something beyond the mind. And such a person will come in your life. And it may take time to recognize him. It may take time for the mind and its doubts to be dispelled. But eventually the power of love will be so strong that you're seeking, and the power of love of that human being will override it, and he'll take you back home. Now, he is going to perform this miracle of taking you back home because he says you are ready for it. The condition in his mind is only one. You are ready to go home, he'll take you home. Period. The rest of the stuff, meditation, doing various stages to, or the various stages to go through, is only for the mind. Meditation is for the mind, not for your soul. Your soul doesn't care. Your soul only wants to be loved. And soul wants to love and be loved, period. It has nothing to do with these other things like thinking and rationalizing and understanding. All that is mental stuff. So the mind is left behind when this experience takes place. He, that ordinary human being whom we call a perfect living master, his perfection is that there is no death, there is no dissolution in our true home. It's a permanent place. It's immortal, eternal. And that's where he takes us. That's where he operates from. Now, there is rare opportunity for us to have such a meeting with a person. But if we are seeking, he will come to us. Secret still remains the same, seeking for the ultimate. Whoever has been seeking for the ultimate is bound to meet a perfect living master. It's as simple as that. You don't have to go around searching for one. It is the job of the perfect living master to search for a seeker. Now, since time is flowing and we go through a time cycle in this physical world, so many people come and go. A perfect living master, being an ordinary person, born ordinary like a human being, he will not be taking care of the entire universe or for all time. Therefore, from time to time, such people will appear. For the seekers will also appear from time to time. And that is why, in any particular lifetime, that human being will definitely have in his hands a list of seekers that he is going to take back home. And he will definitely meet those people by coincidences or accidents or whatever and take them back home. So this perfect living master is carrying a list called List A. Now, that name I have given. Not given, I don't think it's in the scriptures. anywhere, but I say list A because those people for whom he has come in their life, he's bound to take them back in this very life. Then there is also list B. List B is a large number of people he will come across during this process of picking up a few. Many will come over to him. And I heard the phrase which seemed to fit in with this, that many are called but few are chosen. So many will be called, many will see, and they will be marked for future perfect living masters to be taken back home. So I call that list B. So list A is a direct point in time of readiness of a seeker to go back home. And when that happens, such a person comes and takes that person back home. Of course, the person struggles because still living in the mind, living in this world, thinks it's my effort that's going to do everything. Then the effort fails. Then he says, now what should I do? Then he says, no, no, it's no effort, it's all grace. Grace of the master will take me. So the struggle between effort and grace keeps on going on. And when he makes a progress and goes in, he finds that there was no difference in the effort and grace. The effort came because of grace. If we don't have grace, we don't make the effort. At that time, the mind wants to struggle and make the effort. Therefore, the effort is part of grace. And when we find the effort doesn't work, we move on to pure grace, and then grace pulls you. At the end of the tunnel, we find the light, that they were both the same. So it's a great experience. When you go from one level of experience to another, like you go from the physical experience to an astral experience, this physical experience disappears. You only have the astral experience. The astral experience becomes your reality, and you know it's real, because there's so much more reality in that than the physical. It is like going to sleep at night and having a dream state. When you have a dream, the dream is real because you are unaware of the wakeful state. So the dream is real so long as you're dreaming. When you wake up, the dream becomes unreal and this wakeful state becomes the only reality, which means that we can only see one reality at one time. The same is true at higher levels. That when you go to the astral level and experience it, it looks like reality, ultimate reality. Physical was not real. Dream was not real. That's the real thing. When you go higher up, that's become unreal. And the next causal reality, or the reality of the mind, becomes real. Everything else becomes unreal. This goes on till you reach your true home. True home is totality of consciousness where the whole thing exists together, from where the whole thing is originating. The experience of all creation is originating from there. Therefore, when you reach your true home, all of it was unreal and all of it was real. Before that, you have only single reality. But when you reach there, all becomes unreal and all becomes real. Now that's a very different experience. These perfect living masters come and walk with us here with that experience at the same time. Therefore, they are aware of all these levels at the same time. Whereas some enlightened people who have gone to one level, they will come back and talk about that level if they still remember it. Because unfortunately, sometimes when we have a higher experience and we come down here, this becomes reality, we think that's like a dream. When we're having that experience, we thought it was more real. And now we suddenly come to physical reality, must be some kind of a very lucid dream, some very high quality of dream. But this is real. You go back, that becomes real. This was unreal. So this concept of reality keeps on changing depending upon where we are. But when you have the highest level, then all of it is simultaneously with you as reality or unreality, whichever you want to call it, because it's a created reality. It's all a created reality. It's not illusion. The process of illusion has been created to create reality. We didn't use illusion to create illusion. We didn't create shadows. We created reality, and only reality at one time. So that is why these perfect living masters, when they walk amongst us, they come with that awareness of all levels at the same time. They can talk to us from every level without having to go there and check up what is going on there. Whereas if we want to do, we have to go there and check it up what's going on and then forget it when we come back. There was a man who came to me, he said, can we see the future in the astral plane? I said, yes. Can we see the lottery number that's coming up tomorrow? I said, yes. He said, I am going to work very hard now. I am going to work for tomorrow's lottery. He went and saw the lottery number of the next day. And he came back. He forgot. But he remembered a few digits, a couple of digits. They were right and the rest were wrong. So why did it happen? Because we shift our reality from one level to another. It's not that we say we've gone there, we've seen something, we carry it with us. That was real when we saw it. We come here, this has become real. In this real, we forgot. So that is why it's very difficult to carry all that information that we gather there. And when we come to the physical world, because we are experimenting. We have not died and gone there. That would be different. We are still alive in the physical body. We are still part of the physical body. We still have karma to pay off in this physical body. And therefore, we have gone there to have experience of a higher reality. And it's the only reality when we are there. We know clearly, convincingly, that's the only reality. And when we come back, it's lost because this becomes the only reality. Just like the dream. Every night we can go and have a dream, and every time the dream will look real. Not that only once it will look real, next time we will know it will be a dream. Even if you come to know it's a dream. We have some dreams like that. I have had many, many of you must have had a dream where you knew it is a dream. When you have a dream, and in that dream, you come to know, I know this is not real, this is a dream. What do? You tell everybody there. Come, I'll tell you this is a dream. And then you wake up, there's nobody there to tell. But in the dream, even speaking the truth, you are speaking the truth that this is a dream, but you are not aware of it. Because if you were aware, you would know there's nobody, you are creating all those people. There's another strange experience, and that is, how did one become the many? The ultimate truth you will discover in your true home is, there is only one. Totality of consciousness, which generates these experiences, is only one. It's not more than one. But we create the many for a simple reason, that since the essence of the totality of consciousness is basically love, and that's why they say God is love and love is God, basic essence is love, the experience of love in different forms generates these different experiences. The experience of the many is an experience generated to have the essence of love. Because between the many, they can have experiences. The experiences of love between genders is generated later on at the level of the mind. That is when the experience of love between genders, and then it comes down even to attraction, attachment, sex, and all that in the lower levels. But the ultimate is the experience of love which generates the many. And this is all being generated because of the power of consciousness to be conscious of anything it wants to be conscious of. Therefore, the creation, the creative process is not of building blocks anywhere. The creative process is of the totality of consciousness being conscious of something, it becomes creation instantly. And then when it becomes conscious of something else, it becomes further creation. And then it can delegate to part of the creation to create more. And so it keeps on flowering and becomes vaster and vaster creation. Then within the vast creation, it can pick and choose small portions of creation for new experiences for the same one. It's very difficult for me to explain that all of us sitting here are really one. But truth is, we are. If you go to a true home, we'll find it's the one expressing that oneness in all of us. Why? Because each one of us sitting here is experiencing only one, the self. The rest are all experience. You're not having many. You're having one experiencing many. This remains the truth at all levels. It's the truth right here. It's the truth in the dream. In the dream, there's only one dreamer. Supposing you see 1,000 people in a dream, it does not mean 1,000 people are dreaming. One is dreaming. When you wake up, one wakes up and finds all 1,000 were part of one dream. This goes on. Ultimately, ultimate awakening from the dream takes you to one dreamer of all levels of creation. And therefore, the oneness is being expressed in such a multiple forms. There was a thought for the day in a book my wife was reading in the morning. She likes to read every morning, thought for the day. And the thought for the day today was, And I'm glad if you tell her that I mentioned this, she'll be happy. You know, to do my work, I have to keep her happy. The thought for the day was that the snowflakes come in different forms. The source is one. It's all vapor, cloud. From one cloud, the snowflakes come. In the 1800s, a man wanted to take pictures of the snowflakes. And recently, somebody else had put up an exhibition of pictures, photographs of the snowflakes. He took 5,000 snowflakes, and they were all different. So 5,000 snowflakes, you look at their pattern, they're beautiful snowflakes, crystalline design, different, but they all have a slight different design. 5,000 designs from one source. We are trillions of designs from one source. So that's a good example that was given there, that how that oneness is manifesting, and it remains the secret of our awareness. All of us sitting here, if we look at who is experiencing all this, not the body, bodies are many, but it's one awareness that's aware of all. Not two, it's only one awareness that's aware of all. So that's the beauty of this experience of rising to different levels of consciousness. You find all these secrets that I'm sharing with you personally. So whatever you can do, how much you can do, go up to the point where the perfect living master can pull you with his love beyond the mind, and you'll find the truth about who you are. I'll end here and make a break now for lunch, and I'll come back here. And I'll answer some questions if you have. Do a little meditation. And that we'll end the program with that today. And I'll do some more meditation tomorrow with those who are interested. Okay? Thank you very much.